HarperCollins presents Stargazing. The Players in My Life. Written by Ravi Shastri. With Ayaz Memon. Read by Derek Denzil. Dedicated to the fans. Introduction. As a young boy, the name Garfield Sobers resonated with me deeply. My mother introduced me to him by gifting me a book, Cricket Advance, which he had written. My father followed up with stories of his all-round prowess. Sobers' amazing record, his style, his commitment to hard work, it all seemed magical. What a role model for a budding cricketer. Sobers, as I learned later, had worked as an errand boy at a furniture factory in Barbados at the age of 14. He had also played cricket, using whatever was at hand, whenever he could, and become the world's greatest all-rounder. The impact of Sobers and his genius on me is incalculable. I could never reach the same heights in my career, of course. Nobody has, in my opinion. He remains, for me, the most versatile and compelling cricketer of all time. He was my earliest inspiration when I took to cricket almost half a century ago. But he's not been the only one. As I grew into the sport, several other players also made an impression on me. The number increased when I started playing at the first class and international levels, and has continued to do so throughout my years as commentator and coach. Any sport thrives on heroes and role models whom fans want to watch and up-and-coming athletes want to emulate. Their achievements become benchmarks for subsequent generations and inspire them to aim higher, which in turn sustains or grows a sport. For instance, no batsman has been able to better Don Bradman's amazing run-getting or batting average yet. I doubt anyone ever will, but Bradman has been like a beacon for every aspiring batsman of every generation, his own and since, to imitate. The learning, if you are a student of the game, is never-ending, and not just restricted to skills and technique. As an 18-year-old youngster in the Indian dressing room, I was consumed by how Sunil Gavaskar prepared mentally for a match. At 58, and in the dressing room in an altogether different capacity, I find myself equally fascinated by how young Rishabh Pant, a complete contrast to Gavaskar in approach, primes himself for the challenges in the middle. Playing alongside a teenage Sachin Tendulkar in the early 1990s, I could only marvel at how smartly his mind worked on cricket tactics. Even back then, he seemed to be a nudge ahead in working out what the bowler was likely to do next, all quietly expressed. Now, as coach, Virat Kohli's bristling aggression has unerringly stoked the remaining fire in my belly too. He's not one to cede an inch on the ground, but it's not mindless bravado. He just loves to win. Off the field, he's a different person. Virat's capacity to compartmentalize his thoughts, switch on and off when required, is quite amazing. From Richie Benaud, I learnt not only about cricket's nuances, but also why a clumsily knotted tie can put off TV audiences even if one is talking perfect sense. From Ian Chappell, apart from fantastic stories about eminent players and the skills which made them great, I learned that you have to carry your spine with you always, on the field or off it. The thought of doing a book on cricketers, past and current, whom I've admired, enjoyed playing with or against, or watching, and above all, learned from in the past 50 years, came to me in late 2016, during one of my travels for a commentary assignment. 50, I decided, was a good number to settle at, leaving 8 names to be added for a second exercise. That didn't happen till after the 2019 World Cup. My responsibilities as chief coach after the ICC Champions Trophy in 2017 left me with little time to devote to this project. When I finally sat down to finalize the names, the list had swelled way past even 50. Months in lockdown because of the COVID-19 pandemic gave me the opportunity to fast-track the book. The players featured here are those who not only made runs and took wickets, but also influenced cricket in a big way and drew in more fans with their skills and accomplishments. I've had to overlook some current stars like Rishabh Pant, Babar Azam, Marnus Labuschagne, Pat Cummins, Mohammad Shami, Cheteshwar Pujara, Jasprit Bumrah, Ajinkya Rahane, to name a few. But only because they are still building their body of work, I can see these and many other players featuring in my next collection. There will, of course, be disagreements with the cricketers I've written about, and that's okay. All selectors must be sufficiently thick-skinned and prepared to take criticism. Part 1. Growing up into the game. A league of his own. Garfield Sobers. The first I heard of Garfield Sobers was in my home in the early 1970s. Barely 10, I had begun to show some aptitude in both bowling and batting, which kind of impressed my father. "We have a Sobers in the house," he once declared jokingly to his friends who were visiting. I hadn't seen Sobers play when the West Indies toured India in 1966-67. So for the first few years of my cricketing journey, his stupendous all-round skills were known to me only through hearsay, a great deal of it through my father, who was an unabashed fan. Dad was a horse lover, and when he spoke of Sobers, the word used often was pedigree. He would show me photographs of the great West Indian, highlighting his sinewy physique, great sense of balance, batting or bowling, and the way he could draw so much power in whatever he did by making comparisons with pedigreed horses. As my cricketing ambitions and education grew, I made it a point to learn more about Sobers. What I read, and subsequently saw on videos too, revealed an exceptional multi-dimensional player who not only won matches on his own, but did so incomparably. Videos and films give a more vivid expression to sporting action than still photographs. And Sobers' magnificent prowess came through tellingly. Tall and athletic, he batted with panache and timing that separates the great batsman from the very good. He could bowl genuinely fast, fast-medium with late swing either way, or switch to orthodox left-arm spin when needed. Super quick on his feet, Sobers could field in any position, and a strong left arm meant he could throw hard over long distances. After he became captain, he preferred to stand close in to be more involved in the game. And his lightning reflexes and keen ball sets helped him take sensational catches. Though most of the matches Sobers played go far in establishing his batting genius, two are particularly memorable. One was when he played for Nottinghamshire against Glamorgan at Swansea in his debut season in county cricket in 1968. And the other was in 1972 on a fiery Perth pitch as the rest of the world took on Australia. I have watched these contests hundreds of times, as I am sure everyone from my fraternity and those who love and follow the game have done over the years. In the 1980s, it wasn't so easy to get footage, which is now readily available on YouTube, etc. But the effort was worthwhile to understand Sobers' genius. The match at Swansea was remarkable for Sobers' lusty hitting against Malcolm Nash. After the first three balls had been hit over the fence, high on adrenaline, he went for broke, hitting the next three for 6-2, becoming the first batsman in history to do so in one over. His 254 against Australia is rightly considered a classic. It is extraordinary for the quality and range of strokes, which Sobers bats spat out as a machine gun does bullets. A high backlift usually heightens the risk in batting, but also enhances the beauty of strokes. And Sobers was utterly, marvelously, delightfully in control in that knock. He made the Australia attack. Dennis Lilly, Bob Massey, Graham Watson, Terry Jenner, Kerry O'Keefe seem positively mediocre, especially Lily, whom he smashed ruthlessly. I am hardly the type who gets overawed by anything or anyone. But when I first met Sobers in the flesh, on the tour to the West Indies in 1983, I could barely utter a word. I couldn't take my eyes off him and barely registered what he said in his sing-song Barbadian accent. The splendid athlete I had seen on videos was now a man approaching middle age, with a hobbling gait that spoke of years of wear and tear on his knees from playing cricket relentlessly all over the world. Yet, he was still very much a superstar, though he wore his fame lightly. When I found my voice, Sobers was helpful, giving me important tips on batting. I had by then got a promotion up the order, and spin bowling when I asked him how to improve. The abiding lesson, don't underestimate yourself, no matter the reputation of the opponent. In January 1985, batting against Baroda at Bombay, I hit left-arm spinner Tilak Raj for six sixes in an over, which brought me level with Sobers in this rare record. The heady feeling remained with me till I reached home, where my father took me aside briefly, away from all the congratulations and visitors. Fantastic, son, but remember, there can never be another Gary Sobers. I had taken after my old man in being blunt, and our views often clashed. But in this, we were in complete agreement. Play hard, play fair. Ian Chappell. My first cricket hero was Gundappa Vishwanath. But Ian Chappell is the one who I grew up idolizing after being initiated into the sport. There was no TV coverage of overseas cricket in the early 1970s. Radio was the only real-time link to cricket action happening outside of India. I would be glued to Radio Australia whenever matches were played in that country. And this was my introduction to Chappell. There was a buzz around him when he was playing. His name would crop up in the commentary more frequently than any other player, even when he wasn't batting. The 1974-75 Ashes series tipped everything in Chappell's favour, where I was concerned. His dashing approach as a batsman and hard aggression as captain made a huge impact on me. From an early age, I found the so-called niceties of the game somewhat hypocritical. If you don't take the field to win, why play at all? Chappell was the kind of player I wanted to be. He was a polarizing figure in his heyday. He played really hard, but also played fair, as I got to understand which seemed the best way to play. I would read about how he would be in an eyeball-to-eyeball confrontation with opponents on the field, then share a beer with the same person immediately after the game. This was spirit of cricket for me, and made Chappell even more endearing. He was obviously a fantastic captain, not losing a single series. He had the ability to get the best out of his players, and under him, Australia became world beaters in the 1970s. It's not often that players are revered by teammates long after their playing days are over. But Chappell still commands the loyalty of those who played under him. This says something about his character and personal charisma. I got to know Chappell on the several tours we made of Australia from the 1980s and used these opportunities to pick his brain, get insights into why he was so successful as a captain. Essentially, as I understood, this was because he was always looking to take a match forward, not waiting for things to happen. I got to know him better when we became fellow commentators for Mark Mascarenhas' World Tell. Like me, Mark too admired Chappell hugely. And there were several evenings we spent discussing cricket's past, present, and future. He had the reputation of being abrasive, but that was far from the real Chappell, as I discovered working with him. True, he could be as blunt as a shovel, irrespective of the reputation of the other party, but not pointlessly. Only if he believed there was an absence of reason or misuse of position by the other. I love his droll sense of humour too. It takes a while to get used to it, because he is not the boisterous, guffawing kind. He has biting wit, and with age, that has become even sharper. When Mark was around, evenings used to be great fun, because they both were masters at leg pulling, though in contrasting style. Mark was large and loud, with a Yankee's penchant for drama and over-the-top debates. Chapel would be surgeon-like, using his words like a scalpel to make his point. Most of the time, he was an...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.